The frenetic pace of the American Music Awards is already predestined because we have anywhere from 12 to 16 acts cramming into the 3 hours, plus all the awards. It just moves like a freight train, just down the line.
You just had to keep going. There wasn't a moment to catch your breath. You had to keep the energy going.
It was just bang, 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 and it went fast. The Whitney you're about to see was in the Innocent Times.
Whitney is a very dynamic performer. I think her voice range is incredible.
With that magnificent voice, captivating an audience.
She was, you know, a scared little girl who did a wonderful job.
Everybody has always loved Whitney.
When Whitney showed up, you knew she was going to bring the house down.
It was just a very, very happy time in her life.
That voice has never changed at all. She's a brilliant, brilliant singer.
The winner is. When the same person's Whitney.
Whitney Houston!
Once every few years, somebody will sweep.
Whitney Houston!
I don't know what to say.
Thank you. This makes number 10.
Welcome back to the Whitney Houston Show.
She deserved it.
Mommy and Daddy, look, I got another one.
She was hot. She was happy.
And the winner is...
And
Whitney Houston.
The Bodyguard soundtrack.
The Bodyguard, Whitney Houston.
The Bodyguard soundtrack, Whitney Houston.
Guess I just should stay up here, huh?
Michael Jackson.
I think Michael is a different person today than what he was. I think back then he was more fun, he was more open, he was more out there, and I think over the years, ever since Thriller, when everybody started, you know, he couldn't go anywhere, Michael has become very introverted and very shy.
When he came to the American Music Awards with Brooke Shields and Emmanuel Lewis, we all said, great, it's terrific to have Brooke Shields at our show, and Emmanuel Lewis likewise.
That was a huge, huge night for us. It's huge. Everybody in the world who was hot was there that night.
Billie Jean, Michael Jackson. Thriller, Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson. Thriller, Michael Jackson.
The girls in the balcony, I love you, you're wonderful.
It's always been kind of an otherworldly experience to meet Michael Jackson because, I mean, he's so bigger than life. You get the feeling that you're meeting somebody not of this earth. You know, it's just, he's kind of an amazing presence to be around.
Could you lift that up, please? I can't wait. Eddie, I need your help. It ain't working.
Go, like, bend down.
First, I'd like to thank...
Well, you got to remember in those days, Michael Jackson was... just the biggest star in the world, and a little intimidating, and people were intimidated by his presence.
He said, Eddie, pull it up like I was working for him.
And I started to do it too. I was like, yes, Michael, wait, what am I doing?
So when he asked Eddie to move the microphone, and Eddie reacted like, what am I, your manservant or something? It took the tension away and added humanity back in.
First, I'd like to say, can you hold this for me?
Hold the trophy, right. Do this for me. I think, I don't know, maybe in Michael's life, somebody's always doing something for Michael, so he always feels that whoever's there can help him or do something.
He's changed so extraordinarily over the years, and it's hard to explain what's happened.
First time you saw Janet Jackson, you knew she had it. I mean, you just knew it. There was no camera shyness. There was nothing. She just strutted out in front of a camera. She acted. She could be a chanteuse. And you knew that little girl was going to turn out to be something.
She came out like in a Mae West outfit. Doing the whole thing down the stage. Cute as a button. Nobody had any idea she was going to be a performer. But there she was, putting on a performance. I've watched Janet Jackson grow extraordinarily over the years. She'd been on the show several times, but never performed on the show.
When I first started working with Janet Jackson, she was just this sweet, innocent, shy. She was just a sweet, dear heart. And at the time, I was doing the choreography. It was a magical time. There's nothing more rewarding as a choreographer than when you see this unbelievable confidence shine through. It's like, you know, you feel like you're proud. You just feel so proud and you feel so happy for them. All the work, the hard work that Janet did on the Control album paid off. I mean, her image was now set. And to see where she is today, I mean, she's a beautiful woman. People totally recognize her as a leading force now.
And then when you talk to Janet, she's just this very demure, very shy little thing. And I think basically she is, Michael's like that too when he talks though. And then they get out on stage and it's like, va-voom, it all comes out.
They grow into the extraordinarily beautiful woman she is today, and a very sexy lady. And so I'm ashamed to say this because I've known her since she was a kid.
I have great memories of Will Smith. The first time he came on the show, he was DJ Jazzy Jeff in The Fresh Prince.
Will wanted that kind of a set because he wanted the attention on him and his music. He didn't want the attention on set pieces flying in and out and lights changing as much as they might have.
The amazing thing about Will Smith is he's grown from a rap artist to a situation comedy star to one of the biggest superstars in the world. So you gotta know that initially he had the magic.
Yeah, you know, I speak a little French too.
Oh, really? You didn't tell me? I didn't know.
Voulez-vous coucher avec moi ce soir?
A number of years later, he hosted the American Music Awards.
Oh, yeah, we about to have some fun now.
And when he came back, his career had exploded.
Will was a doll, has always been a doll. If I had to pick a favorite on these shows, it would always be Will.
Everybody loves Will Smith.
I could never have visualized that he would have grown to the proportions he's grown to these days.
Oh, man!
I mean, he's the biggest thing around.
Cher was waiting for a call from Elton John she never received, and it upset her, and Cher pulled out of the show.
The last second, thank God, Natalie Cole, Tony Tennille came through.
They did a great job.
He was terrific, not only for his music, but for his sense of humor.
Hey, hello.
Hi.
At last.
Peter, Paul, and Mary. And which one's Mary? Never mind. Go on. What about...
I remember talking to Elton about what he wanted to perform, and it was his choice as to what he wanted to do.
Elton could have sung his current hit, but he decided to do a classic song.
What's great about the American Music Awards is that artists do feel that they have freedom of artistic integrity and to really carry out their vision.
We used to say that this was the toughest, hardest show to get on the air.
We have to roll with the punches.
You just had to keep going. There wasn't a moment to catch your breath.
Something always happens to make it interesting.
In 1985, one of the things that was new for music shows on television was fog. And we had never used it before. And we were doing this number with Julian Lennon, and we thought it would be so cool to have, you know, lots of fog. So the guy started fogging on the stage, and there was an award to be given.
And the winner is...
And the fog started to settle on the ground, seep into the first couple rows of the audience. People were gasping for air, and the fog started to obliterate the picture. It was so thick, you could barely see Tina Turner by the time she got up there.
You couldn't see anything, and no one said a word. We just kept on going. It's a live show. Can't stop.
Metallica! Motley Crue! Van Halen!
Obviously, we don't know who the winners are until the envelope is opened. And you have five cameras, one on each one of the five nominees. And when the envelope is opened and the presenter says the winner's name, you know. As soon as you take that camera and you see the person's face, or you see them, you know, rolling around in their chair, or they can barely stand up, or whatever, you know you're in trouble.
Guns N' Roses, Appetite for Destruction.
When Slash came up on the stage, I knew I was in trouble as soon as I cut to him, because he had a half-empty glass in one hand and a cigarette in the other. And as soon as he opened his mouth, I knew that he was... face?
I want to think.
Oops.
Oops.
All right.
And I knew I had to cut away, or we were going to be in trouble.
Alan Niven for getting us there. Doug Gold.
ABC had a corner.
I mean, the world fell in on us. The affiliates were calling, the networks, I was upset.
But in all honesty, we had no comment because it didn't bother us.
After that, ABC put the American Music Awards on a 7-second delay. That was the beginning of it. It'll go down in the record books.
What was interesting about it was in this murky mess we were in with a lot of music, all of a sudden these fresh-faced guys come out and do their little boy band routine, and it was accepted, and it was huge. And it just shows you that there's a wide variety of choices out there, and people loved it, and it was huge.
And then all of a sudden it was another boy band, and another boy band, and another boy band.
In 2000, NSYNC was just about to go out on tour with No Strings Attached.
The album was coming out 2 months later.
And we were fortunate enough to get them on the American Music Awards to open the show.
I mean, this is the first time anybody ever seen this. The song was like making its national debut.
Sid and Marty Croft, the famous puppet designer, designed those puppets.
Those puppets, I don't know how tall they were, 30, 40 feet tall.
They were supposed to dance.
It was five different men or women operating each one of these, and it was like nuts.
We were there till very, very late at night rehearsing it. It never worked right.
It just was a rat's nest. It was awful.
A couple of the groups backstage in t-shirts. It was something like, no more puppets or something.
And it got to be very tense at one point.
I think for the most part, everybody was just, you know, eager and on top of their game.
When you're trying to work out kinks for something that you're going to take on the road, an AMA rehearsal schedule is kind of not the time to work out those kinks.
You can understand why they were so intense about it, but it was tough on us.
It was like our first coming out party as far as this album was concerned, and to be performing at the AMAs, you know, that's a huge, huge honor. So we were all nervous, and I think that's why the rehearsals were so intense. You know, intense rehearsal leads to an intense performance, so, you know, I think that's just how we are.
The end result was so phenomenal. It was worth the while.
Ready to hand out the award for the favorite pop rock band or group?
I knew if we won that award that there were going to be some guys in the audience who were like, what? They thought U2 should have won. And I was even like that. You know, I mean, U2 are legends.
And the winner is NSYNC!
I remember the audience booing. You hear booing, you go, what was that? What happened?
Oh, quit booing. U2's gonna get Grammys.
It's important to have a sense of humor. I mean, U2 has enough awards. We need some awards, okay? I'm just kidding.
Thank you guys very much for supporting us. Thank you.
I mean, we all have good sense of humor, so everybody thought it fit right in.
All right, stop! Collaborate and go dance!
I don't think Vanilla Ice was accepted as much as he wanted to be. Back in 91, there was rumors going around about his background not being real, people not knowing where he came from, who he is. You could absolutely see the chip on his shoulder. You heard it.
Word to your mother and the people who try to hold me down and talk bad about me, kiss my white butt. Word to your mother.
The awards absolutely meant nothing to me, to be honest with you. They're sitting at my house for shits and grins, just collecting dust. If I wasn't white, I wouldn't probably have received half the criticism I did. But you know, that just happens when you're the first one out the gate and you're on top of the world. You're outselling every black artist who ever did the music.
Well, if you go back to 1991, look at the charts, see what was hot at that time, and you'll see Vanilla Ice was at the top of the charts. The man deserved to be on the show.
I paved the way for Eminem, Fred Durst, Kid Rock, and every one of them. I mean, basically, you know, they can capitalize on my career and they know now what to do and what not to do.
Ice. Word to your mother!
Achy breaky heart, Billy Ray Cyrus.
There were an awful lot of people who criticized. They were just a pretty face, couldn't sing. They were, you know, really down on it, getting a lot of bad press.
There have been those people, perhaps due to paranoia or insecurities, or perhaps they consider themselves a self-proclaimed critic. To those people who don't like Achy Breaky Heart, here's a quarter, cause someone who cares.
And you're watching the monitor and everybody kind of went, What was that?
I looked at that tape the other day and I said, what's the chipmunk doing there? First show to do a lot of things because we didn't know better.
We wanted to bring across what was going on in the world that day.
So we have to try to stay on the edge. Fire. Oh, the sexy dancers. Fire.
In 1976, when I saw the Ohio Players, it was like watching something out of Playboy.
Yes, it does. And in looking at it in retrospect, I say, this is very mild. But in those days, wow, that's hot. The good old days.
It was probably a precursor to Britney Spears.
Listen, Britney, I was promised that you'd be wearing something nasty.
Whatever, man. Woo, I feel so much better.
Just listen. Over the years, we had some very interesting presenters. Dick and I, we wanted to get a little bit more hip. We decided to go after rock and rollers. And you think some people are not obtainable, and you make a phone call. Before you know it, you're not getting a no, you're getting, hey, you know what? That sounds like fun.
Stupid boys.
Stupid boys.
The network did want the copy in advance. They got the copy, but what Ron and Keith said was not the copy that ABC got.
Now, we'd like Ron and I would like you all now to devote all your attention to us. And if you would, be so kind as to spit in our direction, and we'd like to give you a version of Singing in the Rain.
I had no idea where they came up with this stuff. It wasn't prepared. It was something they dreamed up backstage, but they had materials to do.
Oh, but is that what people are saying about me? They're always accusing me of having some sort of madcap sense of humor.
Well, if they are, Keith, they're being very...
Donny Osmond and Michael Jackson, two big teen idols of the day, with equal hairdos, I might add. And we brought out two little kids, Rodney Allen Rippey, who'd been doing hamburger commercials, and Ricky Siegel, who was on a situation comedy. And it looked like miniatures of the big guys.
Do you know the next award?
The next award is for the favorite pop group.
Do you know the nominations?
No.
Well, the winner is...
American Music Awards was a platform unlike any other award show because of Dick Clark. He would bring on African-American artists and introduce them to mainstream America.
Run DMC were the first big rappers we ever had on a huge nighttime primetime television show. It was an alien sound to a lot of ears, but they were so big, so powerful, it was the thing to do.
Everybody was just like, it's about time. You know, rap is here to stay and it's not gonna go away.
That award show audience in our show is filled with all the stars. And they're usually very passive. They don't really get stirred up, but that got them.
It was almost impossible, especially during that time, to sit because rap was still so new to people. So they had to get up.
Fool, without any further ado.
Yeah, do it, baby.
What's your name, fool? Snoop Doggy Dogg.
Everybody was scared to death of the Snoop Doggy Dogg performance. His lyrics were so outrageous and so uncontrollable. The immediate reaction was, how could you have the nerve or the gall to book Snoop Doggy Dogg?
Dick is the one that came up with, Larry, what do you think about Snoop Dogg being on the show?
People said, have you gone over the edge? I said, no, we're on the edge. We gotta have this guy.
I know it was a lot of talk about it because they didn't really want me to perform.
And I know that Dick Clark went to bat for me on the American Music Awards, and he stood up for me.
ABC wasn't quite sure what was going on lyric-wise because they were using a lot of urban lingo.
They had a book of urban street language that they went through. They'll say, what does this mean? And what does that mean? I said, it doesn't matter. You can't hear it anyway.
So what they did is we sent two different mixes. One, the normal mix, which was in the audience, and the other mix for the broadcast, which is what the rest of the world heard.
And for them to put it through that kind of examination, you know, it made me feel honored, you know what I'm saying, that they was even taking that much time to even get into something that took me 25, 30 minutes to write.
ABC is always nervous, but they'll get over it.
It was just cool that he let me do it. Who's the man with that dance? That was the first time I had rocked the Afro on TV, so, like I said, I had to put that a good oil sheen and that good Fred oil, because it looked real tight, like Michael Jackson in the 70s, you know, with that shine. Yeah. Okay.
The American Music Awards gives an artist an opportunity to be known as one thing and make the transition to something else.
Let's go.
And the winner is Shania Twain.
Shania Twain was known as a country artist, and she came on the American Music Awards and sort of changed from country to rock and roll.
I think Shania Twain always tries to dress so she's not country. That year, I remember that outfit.
She came out and she was wearing a pair of painted-on leather pants.
The vinyl.
She came out looking like the queen of rock and roll. She looked so, so hot, and the audience was like, wow.
I'm out of here.
Prince at that time in his life was surrounded by a horde of people that said you can't talk to him, don't face him, don't address him when he comes on the set.
Prince's people sent out a memo to everybody that was supposed to be sitting in the same row as him that nobody was to establish eye contact with Prince. This is a real thing. This like went out to everybody that was like, you know, Night Ranger got this memo. Oh, I can't look at Prince. Well, okay, good. So, you know, as a joke, I sent out a memo to Prince saying, yeah, Prince, don't look at me either, okay?
For all of us, life is death without adventure.
When Prince was on the show in 1995, he'd gone to the symbol for his name.
There was on the schedule, the rundown, dressing room door sign.
I don't even know how they got this. They made the little symbol. The symbol will appear. The symbol's dancers will appear. But nobody knew what to call it.
So we had cards printed up with that symbol on it. And when Prince walked in, we all did, hi, and we held up the logo. He has a sense of humor, of course, and he laughed.
Peace and be wild.
So we brought everybody.
Every rehearsal we did, they went full out. You know, it was never half.
Hammer kept saying, I need more, I need it louder, I need it louder, I need it louder.
The name of the song was Here Comes the Hammer. Well, here I come. Don't now, if I'm really coming, don't go, boo-boo, here come. No. Bop, bop, bop! No sound of trumpets, man, here I come.
And we kept turning it up, and it was so loud in there, people's ears were starting to bleed.
Oh, the pains. The level of the volume was excruciating.
It was quite unequivocally one of the loudest things I've ever mixed.
In the Shrine, it wasn't ready for that.
All of a sudden, out of the ceiling came this big, and I mean it was that big, piece of concrete.
We literally brought the roof down.
A piece of the plaster just missed my left ear.
It needed it anyway. If we could shake it loose, it was time to renovate, baby. That was a great moment because it was like, whoa! You know, everybody was blown away by the big show, the decibels, you know. Everybody was like, wow, this, man, I didn't expect that, you know. This is a party, and that's what I wanted to do. Stop!
The most memorable years as a producer for the American Music Awards were the Lionel Richie years. 1984. Lionel Richie opened the show with All Night Long, and I wanted to see it live on the air for the first time, really, the way I wanted the audience at home to see it. And we winged it, and it made it so exciting. The audience went nuts. Feel it in your heart.
Lionel was very, very hot at the time, and I had to convince him to host the show. He said, I'm scared to death. I can't do it. I don't want to. And I said, look, I'll be right there with you. We'll talk you through it. Once we got him to do it once, then we couldn't get him away.
Look out! We're going to be running with the night!
Woo! He could handle any situation once the fear of the unknown was over.
Lionel came right across the television set into your living room.
That night, he created this word, outrageous.
The key word for tonight is outrageous.
And he must have said it 100 times during the night.
Outrageous!
Outrageous.
Outrageous. Outrageous!
It was outrageous.
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 Outrageous!
Outrageous, outrageous, outrageous.
Outrageous!
And didn't he do something with his arm or hand?
Outrageous! Outrageous!
Oh, the one word?
Outrageous!
I came up with the idea of showing up at the American Music Awards wearing the exact same hairstyle as Coolio.
I wasn't like the biggest Weird Al fan or anything. You know, I don't think he was the biggest Coolio fan either.
It takes like 3 hours, I think, to get my hair to look like that. And my scalp is pretty tender to begin with, and they have to yank your hair and twist it around these wires. There's actually wires inside my hair when I'm doing that.
Nah, I had no idea. They kept that from me.
I didn't know Coolio real well at that time. And I was concerned that if Weird Al came out with a mock Coolio hairdo, that he'd be, you know, angry.
I did spot him right before we came out.
I think we had 30 seconds, really, literally, before they had to come on.
And he laughed and gave me a big handshake, and he said, hey, who does your hair? That's pretty good. He even showed me how to do the Coolio walk. He said, okay, when you walk out there, you gotta walk like this. I mean, like, we're rehearsing the Coolio walk.
I just didn't want him looking all corny, you know, walking Weird Al style, you know. He had to represent correctly. I'm always cool with it. I mean, I make fun of people every day. That's what it was all about. I mean, we're entertainers, so, you know, that's what we're doing. We're entertaining.
Somebody brought Pat Boone to me, and he was wearing a robe or something.
Pat Boone, as everybody knows, is the white bread rocker from the 50s, clean as can be, blue suede shoes.
All of a sudden, he took this robe off.
I'd like to introduce you to the future of heavy metal.
I said, are you sure you want to do this? And he goes, I'm ready.
Pat Boone.
Oh, you could hear from the first floor up to the balcony. They loved it.
Alan.
We got him into so much trouble. He had come up with this idea and said, great idea. I mean, it's just stepping out of character for you as Mr. Goody Two Shoes.
Alice, they're laughing at you. You're looking
what
good.
Is this?
Does this signify the death of heavy metal? No, it's a whole new rebirth.
Unfortunately, it backfired in the religious community. He took a lot of heat. But on the other hand, people were talking about Pat Boone in a big way.
R. Kelly!
You know, on these live shows, you have no control over what the people bring up to the podium, what their state of mind is.
You got carried away.
I bet you I can make your body talk to me. All I need is my CD, a bagel, and some Christie.
Nobody really knew what he was singing about. And I could see Dick picking out from the other side of the stage doing this.
And when you leave about my room, or you be walking bowlegged. I can keep a body coming like CTA. You're dealing with a true baller, baby.
We had no idea what he was doing, and that was what was on his mind at that moment.
Sliding that sexy ass down a pole like what, 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 what? Come and get some of this R&B thug, babe.
The favorite artist of the year is Garth Brooks.
We had a new category. And we wanted one artist to be considered the artist of the year. And when it came time for him to make his acceptance speech, he astounded all of us.
Hootie and the Blowfish were hot that year, and he thought in his own mind they should have received that award.
I never thought he would have done what he did do when he got it.
I cannot agree with this.
music is made up of a lot of people, and if we're one artist short, then we all become a lesser music. So without any disrespect to the American Music Awards, and without any disrespect to any fans who voted, for all the people who should be honored with this award, I'm gonna leave it right here. Thank you very much.
And as a result, that was the only time we ever did that. We did it one time, the guy left the trophy on the podium, never to be seen again, gone.
For the first time ever, a father and son, Julio and Enrique, are competing for the same award.
It was weird because Julio and Enrique weren't sitting near each other, and it just seemed like they were very disconnected as father and son.
There was some brouhaha that if Julio did not win, he was gonna leave.
And the winner is Julio Iglesias.
It just was an awkward moment.
You know, when they tell you that your son is against you in competition, you feel a little like your brain's in another place, because I adore my kids. And more than anything, to tell my son and my new sons that as much I will be on a stage, as much I will compete with them.
People were like, huh? What? It came off as though there was something going on there.
They're a father and son, they love each other dearly, but they're also both pop singers, and there's a competition between the two of them. That's just given. And that was very cool, I thought, to be competing with one another.
There are 3,000 seats in the Shrine Auditorium in the balcony, and that's where the fans sit on the American Music Awards.
I thought, we'll take this young, good-looking guy